Thanks everyone for coming back from the coffee break. I always have the impression when I give a talk after a coffee break, the audience is still having a coffee. So thanks for that. So as I'm very happy to be here, thanks to the organizers. As Maxime was mentioning, I'm going to talk about the space repetition that I guess there was already an intro and even an app that is using it. So let's go into the actual work, no? I guess one of the reasons why many of us are here is because this idea that machine learning AI in recent years, you have seen that they has been used for many applications that we use nowadays. No, they can translate almost as people translate from one language to another, recognize images. You can go to your phone and say, oh, look for photos of cats, and they are, or even they can play games. No, and the promise is that, instead of doing that, can we use machine learning not only to translate from one language to another, but after to actually help people to become better at translating, to become better at learning some of the language. So it's not a matter of let's say automating some task, but making people to be better at some task. So when we think about learning, no, you can distinguish two types of learning. There is declarative language, declarative learning, that is something like, for example, learning a language. No, you can just read about it, you can study it, and eventually, if you practice talking to others, you learn to speak a language. There is some other language that is more the language, some other learning that would be more like driving a bicycle. You can read books about riding a bicycle, but somehow you would have to ride it to actually learn it. Okay. So in this talk, I'm going to focus on declarative learning. So what is the idea? No, is that many of you, I guess, if you are not like Swiss or French, you have to learn French here. So a bit the idea is that you learn it by repetition. It's like, oh, if, for example, there, no, I put an example with Spanish because I'm from Spain, you want to learn how to say trousers in Spanish, you would start to kind of practice the word over and over again. You just repeat it, like every day I'm going to learn how to say trousers in Spanish. So here in this context now, was already said this morning, is very well known since as back as late 19th century, that it's good to actually space these repetitions. What it means is that maybe initially you learn one day about trousers, tomorrow you practice again, you have pantalon words, and then you just space the repetition to 2 days, so after 3 days you practice again, and so on. So and this a space repetition means that over time you practice less and less a word, and you do that because in that way you can learn other words. So a bit, the idea now is that this concept is, I don't know how many of you heard ever about these Leitner systems of cards, okay, at least two in the audience, okay. It's this idea though, that you have little cards with, for example, words in a language, and you have different piles. And all the piles or decks start on the left, and if it turns out when you take a card you remember it, you put it in the deck two, okay? If you don't remember, it stays in deck one. And the process continues in several decks, and if each of these decks, you are revisiting like with longer and longer delay. So that is kind of to simulate this idea of a space repetition. And this you can go online, there are many apps that you can use this, you don't have to have the decks and somehow the cards, physical cards. But here the question now is that now you go to these online apps or even platforms, Duolingo, I guess many of you know, and a bit the idea is that you can actually track how learners are doing over time. You can see for all these repetitions whether the learner were succeeding at recalling the word, okay? So you can think of data sets that is like for all the words in Spanish, you could have the identity of all the learners and whether over time they were actually recalling it or they were failing. So this seems a bit like a machine learning problem, no? You have all this data, and a bit the question we try to kind of answer is to say, can we actually help these people to decide when to review each of the words? But not to do it as an ad hoc rule, like 1 day, after 2 days, after 4 days, but to actually optimize for this time interval, okay, and optimize on data. So what is the hope here, no? The hope is the following, that already since this researcher I showed you at the beginning, this Ebbinghaus, did some lab experiments and realized, oh, memory is actually decreasing exponentially. In the sense that when you revisit a word here, pantalon, in the moment you're actually reading it, you recall it, you remember it, but then over time, there is a probability that you forget it. Means that, for example, at this point in time, the probability that you remember may be like 20%. So a bit the idea now is that based on these lab experiments and more work that is more recent, you can try to actually fit this exponential. You can try to find out from the data how quickly you forget each of the words. Okay? And not only that, but you can also try to estimate every time you review a word, if you recall it successfully, how much actually this change the forgetting rate. The idea is that if you remember a word, means that the forgetting rate seems to be decaying slower. Okay? And if you don't remember it, seems that you are forgetting faster. So a bit idea is that these parameters, that to say the initial decay rate, how quickly you forget, and how much you actually change this rate every time that you review and you successfully recall it or unsuccessfully recall it, we can estimate this from the data. Okay? So a bit idea is that given all these words, we can actually find a difficulty parameter that you could think is how quickly, typically, people in average forget about that word, and also how much the practice is actually influencing this forgetting rate. How much you actually reduce it or increase it when you recall an item successfully or unsuccessfully. And I'm not gonna put here some plots that you see some performance and you say, well, okay, fine. But a bit idea is that we can validate that this can be predicted accurately. No, that the resultant model, if you take a learner, can say, okay, after this period of time, is gonna recall it or is not gonna recall it. Okay? So, now, a bit the intuition of the work that we did is to say that when you are thinking in how frequently you should show a person an item for review, like one of these words for review, you can think on in terms of rate of reviewing. Okay? That you could say, oh, I'm going to show this word like three times every week, or something like that. And a bit the idea is that you would like this rate of reviewing to be changing over time. And that you do it adaptive, so that depending how they are doing, how much they are recalling this word, you just increase the rate or reduce the rate. Okay? Why do we do that? Is that maybe some of you here, maybe even you studying EPFL, heard about dynamical systems, no? That you would say in physics or in engineering, you think many times about dynamical systems. That is simply a mathematical description of some nature system, some technological system. So a bit the idea is that when we start to think about rate of reviewing, we can think on this process of recalling and reviewing, forgetting, and so on, as a dynamical system. So we are modeling kind of the reviewing activity of a human and the forgetting activity of a human as a dynamical system. Why that is important? Because in the moment that we actually have a dynamical system, we can do something that is called stochastic optimal control, that maybe some of you heard. That a bit the idea is if you have dynamics that you can express mathematically, you can make interventions. You can decide about the reviewing rate that is optimal, no? And in this work in particular, what we did is to say, oh, if our, let's say, objective is over time to somehow reduce the error. Here, doesn't matter the math so much. It's simply to say if you care about decreasing the forgetting probability or increasing the recall probability over time, and at the same time, you don't want to review a lot. So you would like to penalize high reviewing rates. We managed to show that somehow the optimal reviewing rate is just proportional to the probability of recalling. Okay? Meaning that if you are very likely to recall someone, to remember something, the reviewing rate should be low. You shouldn't show it. If it is very likely that you have forgotten an item, you should quickly show this item. No? And to show you visually what this means, imagine again the word pantalon that we have there and our learner. Okay? And a bit the idea is that imagine that initially you start from here, and at this point was the time that you first saw pantalon. So at that point, the recall rate, the probability of recalling was 1. And from that point on, start to decrease. You start to forget. So a bit the idea is to say when you are forgetting means the reviewing rate should increase, so it's more likely that you actually saw this, this event, that you saw the word to the learner. And the process continues every time that you show, you update the rate, and you start keeping track of the reviewing rate that is just proportional to the recall, inverse proportional, and you continue like that. No? So a bit idea is that as you keep tracking how people forget, you keep changing the reviewing rate. Okay? And a bit how do we actually validate that the whole thing works? No? So a bit idea is that it's something publicly available. I mean, everybody can take this dataset that is from Duolingo, no? That you have like 12 million of what they call study sessions, In each session, you can have like a learner that answers multiple questions, and each of these questions has multiple words to fill in. No, some example is these translation exercises, some others is to just put a word in a sentence that is missing this word. So a bit this idea now is that can give us for pairs of users and words using this session, you have like 5 million of these users, user word pairs. So what it means is like, for example, for this word pantalon and some learner, a specific one, you would have a sequence that tells you when the learner was reviewing this word and whether it was successful or not. Okay? And a bit the point now is to say, oh, well, this is observational data, no? You didn't use your algorithm. Here is when Duolingo decided to show these particular words is when the data you have. No? But here is a point, is that the learners, they don't follow all the time Duolingo. And Duolingo doesn't time things. I mean, it's when you open the apps, you start to practice, you end up with some time. Okay? So what we did here is the following. First, we started to just group these user word pairs. We just first group them for number of repetitions, meaning, okay, here is 3 repetitions, well, 3 plus 1, or here is 3 plus 1. So all these ones are 4 of them, 4 repetitions. Okay? And we also pair them by the training period. That training period we call how long did it take to do 3 repetitions. Okay? So we cluster all these pairs of words and users by the number of repetitions and by the time period. Okay? And now here comes kind of the trick, no? That we can compute for each of these sequences that we have, how likely is that our algorithm would have actually recommended such a thing. And we can also see how likely is that a random scheduler would have recommended such a sequence. So in a way, from all these sentences that we have in observational data, we can just extract the ones that are more similar to our algorithm, and more similar to a random baseline, or more similar to an algorithm that is used in some of these systems. So in a way, we are kind of doing some kind of matching, of saying, oh, all these sequences seems as if they were returned by our algorithm. Okay? And once we have that, we can use the last review item for computing some quality metric to say, okay, in this case, it's this empirical forgetting rate, but it's not that important. So a bit idea is that, oh, for each of these sequences, we just loop it to our algorithm or the algorithms by just matching how likely they are that they were produced by one of these algorithms. And a bit, I mean, I said I was not going to put plots, but I guess I have to put some plots. No, so that the idea is that when you actually compute this quality metric across number of reviews, number of repetitions in the words, and also that you can see that for different time intervals also happens that the lower is the better, and the algorithm that we propose is the one that is in green, I believe, if that is green. So it's like, I mean, for all kind of time periods or all kind of number of repetitions, turns out the sequences that are more similar to the ones our algorithm would have recommended are the ones that actually lead to better performance. Okay. And a bit to go, oh, how do we move from there? No, is that until now what I show you is to say, oh, at some point I kind of hide it and say, no, there is this objective that we try to minimize the error and minimize the reviewing rate. And there was some quadratic cost there. That is kind of arbitrary. It's for the maths to work. No? But we have some other work that was published last December where we use reinforcement learning instead of modeling the whole thing as a dynamical system. And this allows us to actually experiment with other costs that are not quadratic and other objectives. Okay? And another recent work also is the fact that here I was just saying, oh, we are timing when we show the word to the people. But sometimes you don't have control of that. I mean, you can just select what the people are going to see, but you cannot tell them when to look at it. I mean, sure, you can have an app that says come back in 2 hours, but may happen that doesn't happen. So we have some other work that instead of choosing the time to show a word, we choose the set of words to choose at a time that the user actually decides to connect. And regarding to this idea of a space selection, no, to decide, oh, which items do you show in a session, rather than to say when to review. We have some ongoing collaboration with a startup actually from Switzerland, I think they are in Basel, that they somehow let us to actually try this space selection. And it's a set of apps that they use for kind of studying for, I don't know, car driving this standardized test, no? That most of the times is about memorizing the answers to some set of questions that are standard. And the initial results, they are kind of very promising, that somehow the resulting algorithm, yeah, compared with some kind of random baseline that choose randomly the items, of course, that is better. But compared to the previous algorithm that they have in their apps, it makes a difference that is like, in terms of some quality metric, is improving like about, I guess, 10% from 60% to 65%, whatever that means in terms of quality metric. But a bit the idea is that this is kind of an interventional experiment, it's not something observational. It's actually that the algorithm was deciding about the scheduling. And yeah, if you want to know more about this project, it's published in PNAS, and I guess you can search online. If you search for my name, you will find it. We also released the code, and we released the post-processed data set from Duolingo, that you can find it also in the original source. It's very, very easy to use. And that's all. Thanks.